So one question that I get all the time, and you can imagine what question that is while playing the Wohltemperierte Klavier of Bach, is of course, what temperament are you playing in? What temperament did you choose to play the Wohltemperierte or the Well-Tempered Clavichord? Excuse me, the Well-Tempered Klavier. And that's an interesting question, and I'm going to give you my personal reflection on that, saying up front that I'm going to make a more extensive series of videos on temperament and Bach temperament and temperament in the 18th and 17th century when we are doing our second project on the Wohltemperierte Klavier. So that will be in within a few months. So Prelude and Fugue number 9 until I believe then 17 or 16. So that is for then. First, if you are a new viewer here on Authentic Sound, my name is Wim Winters and I play and share the beauty of the music from Bach to Beethoven with you. And the word discover is really in the center of everything I do, the curiosity to dive into that strong line of tradition, connect Bach to Beethoven, taking sometimes a new and perhaps even a surprising stand, hopefully to inspire you as a musician and as a listener. So if you would like to join our little community, please be free to hit the subscribe button, and that would be great. So, one disclaimer before I'm going to dive in together with you on my temperament choice, because I know it's heavily debated, and it's often today, I'm going to make a separate video on that. It's often today not easy to talk about one's choices. I've been in some crossfire recently on this particular Facebook group just by sharing my ideas on tempo and things like that. And I sometimes don't understand that, because it's the nature of doing research, which is a part of our chosen name. I didn't choose it. Historically informed performance. That means information is not something from music that is written 200 or 300 years ago. It's not something that you can find by making a telephone call to the composer. It's something you have to find. Of course, great works have been published, and that's all true. But at the end, it is nothing more than some facts that you can think about and take into your personal practice, reflect on them, actually have the source of your experience poured over that bunch of facts that you want to consider. And who is ever going to claim that he or she has understood everything right in the context of the time, and that last thing is probably the most difficult thing that of all, that the context that these facts were written in and produced, that changed so much that it sometimes it should surprise us if we as players who play on period instruments and want to come as close to the original thoughts of the composer that we are studying and playing, it should surprise us if shocking, so to say, new perspectives are not poured over us musicians daily almost, because there is a lot to be discovered and put into right context. So one of the things with temperament is that, of course, today we have a kind of belief that the unequal temperament is something that was really typical for the Baroque time and actually for the whole 18th century. And in one way or another, that's partly, I think, true, but in one way or another, that became a kind of foundation of one of the big foundations under the hip movement, that if you play a period instrument and you will be asked, and certainly as a keyboard player, of course, as a keyboard player, you will be asked constantly, what temperament are you using? And as long as it is an unequal temperament, it's fine. Doesn't matter what the consequences are of that. It doesn't matter what the background philosophy is that. It doesn't even matter. And now I'm saying from personal perspective and personal experiences, doesn't even matter that you have found that information in some sources or created your own truth about that. And I might sound a little bit black and white, but think about it and think about your own practice and your own experience as a keyboard player. and what your own ideas about that. Secondly, I would like what I think, and again, that also will be a separate video. I believe strongly that when this hip movement became really a big movement, and I'm not talking now about the Landowska Dolmetsch period, because I think that it might, all of that we're doing now might, well, it might have been born much earlier, but then, certainly with Dolmetsch, the things he published are really mind-blowing. If you're not familiar with that person, you should dive into that. He was really far ahead of his time. But the hip movement, from the Gustav Leonhardt period maybe, so the 60s, early 70s, and certainly a little bit later with the big record labels, that became, in that period, a movement with a new audience. And typically, if you think about that, there was a big need about on a group definition. I mean, there was not such thing as historically performed performance practice on a large scale still today. Think about it. We as a family of hip players, we are only a niche market within the still big opera houses and concert hall market of regular player performances. So just playing on modern instruments, you know what the difference is. So still that is a very small niche market. It's much bigger than in Leonhardt's time, of course. I mean, in the early 60s or 70s, they had to defend a position on stage. They had to exist. And so if you are interested in this kind of psychology, which I am, and I've read a lot about that, the best way to exist is to organize also a kind of opposition to oppose to what exists, what is existing. So I believe that they didn't do that on purpose or really by nature of differentiating themselves of, I mean, the Leonhardt generation of what existed before them or at the time when they were starting or just filling that large, these large possibilities that I got through these recording labels that at the time, of course, sniffled the kind of economical success which has became the authentic performance practice. It was a label. And so I believe that many things that became the foundation of the hip movement as an equal temperament is one of them, perhaps is found more its birth in the wish to oppose what was there already. So of course everybody, all musicians, all orchestras, of course an orchestra, I mean, it was equal temperament from the earliest types of music that they brought on stage, of course, until the 20th century music. There was no idea of going back to unequal temperament on large stages. So it's very normal and very natural that at the beginning, those pioneers, as we call them, they differentiated themselves by applying unequal temperament, as they applied also the short appoggiatura and not the long anymore. And there is also not so much evidence for that. Not saying that I am the one who's going to tell you what you should do, but it's like it's as it is. And I could continue a little bit like that. So, and I'm going to answer what kind of temperament I'm using. But first this, I, of course, coming from the organ world and as an organist, even playing on the most beautiful historical organs that Europe has, and even working as an organ consultant. But there, an organ restoration, reconstruction of temperament is very difficult because you have organ pipes who have been altered and modified to mostly equal temperament. So we don't change that more than we need to, because everything we do in restoration should be reversible. But I honestly was not, when I came to the clavichord in 2008, not so busy with temperaments. And so I asked the builder of my instrument, Joris Spotvlieger, what he used as a temperament, and he used a kind of, let's say, Werkmeister 3/Joris Spotvlieger temperament. And that's one thing you have to understand, and you understand quickly if you are a keyboard player, you will know that all the historic temperaments that we have are all theoretical. It's almost impossible to apply them in reality because it's a living instrument. And I'm going to demonstrate in the CPE Bach series also the temperament that CPE Bach, according to what I believe, used and advocated. So I used that. I changed quickly to a kind of Valotti temperament, which is maybe most one of the most unhistorical ones. It's late. It's of course written. Mr. Valotti produced that temperament in the 18th century, but was not so widely spread and not so much used as I understand it. So, and, but I used that because it's very easy. It's just temper 6/5. So in order, starting from F. I believe that I did, and so going downwards, and then the six others were pure. So very easy, you checked it, some thirds, and then you start to stretch some intervals. And there started for me the search for temperament. Playing the partitas, I hit my face to the wall several times, and it was not about the thirds. It's not about the quality of the thirds, it was about the fourths and the fifths. Intervals. So Bach has many places where he just has two voices, like the beginning of the third partita. So I think that's the Fantasia of it's a beginning piece, A minor. And when Bach modulates, and he modulates all the time, it's like César Franck in the 19th century, modulate toujours. So you once had a passage, and you have to try that partita, where the fifths and quartet intervals are kind of pure, and then you go to, of course, an impurity, because that's the nature of unequal temperament. And I hated that so much, because it destroyed the complete structure of the piece. There was not one element I could think about why this one segment should sound pure and in tune, and the other one should sound awful, because that it did. By nature, so I started stretching those intervals, and until I said to myself, it's impossible to play this in an unequal temperament. It's probably even not meant to do. Why is Bach modulating all the time? He's shifting, and I should make an overview of the modulations in the partitas, but this is gigantic. And so I shifted to what was a kind of equal temperament. Tuned to my ears, that's different than equal temperament like a piano tuner would do today, but it's of course having all fifths diminished a little bit, and I was really happy with that. Of course you have to adapt a little bit to the what harsher thirds, but that's something you really get adapted to very soon. And then I started to read about that, and I suddenly came to some articles, and we're going to talk about that later. Certainly in later projects with the Wolfgang Peter Clavier, that gave an overview of all sources. And I realized there are not so many sources in the 18th century that talked about unequal temperament in the relationship to 24 keys, playing in 24 keys, which is of course not what the partitas were about, but Bach was not compromising on modulating. So the weirdest keys you have and you will find in the partitas. So, and suddenly you start seeing the connection, and that is what happens if you open your mind for that and you take another perspective, that all the authors of the 18th century, and I'm thinking on one that I know that is an exception, but I don't think there is, that speak explicitly about playing in 24 keys. If you want to do that, then you have to use a temperament that allows you to do that. And it's stressed all the time that you should find a temperament that levels out the intervals and certainly the thirds. So the equal temperament was something that is overwhelmingly present in those sources, starting, and that was a shock to me, with Werkmeister, his last temperament that was published in 1707, 1 year after his death, was called explicitly the Wohltemperierte Stimmung. I mean, how close can you come to Wohltemperierte Klavier? It's 15 years later, and Bach didn't met Werkmeister, but Walter did, and Bach and Walter, of course, did. I mean, there is a connection. Werkmeister explicitly writes that if you want to play it in 24 keys, you have to give up the purity of some tonalities that you had before. And then you're not going to retune every time your keyboard. That's never done. And if you have, if you are professional in a way that you need your keyboard in a stable tuning all the time, you will know that changing temperament is causing some instability in tuning. So the instrument needs some days to recover from that, depending on how far that you are off, of course, of the first temperament compared to the second one. So Werkmeister did that, and I wrote Neidhardt. He talks about gleichschwebend. He has four types of temperaments. If you are just an organist in a small village, you don't need all the keys, he says. So of course you don't need equal temperament. But if you are on the court, meaning if you really have to be a very good player, and who was able to play on 24 keys, by the way, at that time, it was something new, then you have to use gleichschwebend. So it continues. Even C.P.E. Bach, we'll see, talks about diminishing almost most fifths, and that's the part of the quote that's taken always to prove, quote-unquote, that C.P.E. Bach didn't advocate equal temperament. But actually, he is describing equal temperament from a very practical standpoint, and he must have been an exceptionally well tuner, because he says, well, you have to make sure if you want to play in 24 keys, again, if you don't, there is no necessity for that. Why would you compromise the beauty of the thirds if you only play in 6 or 7 tonalities to do that? So, but Immanuel Bach writes that you have to make all the thirds gleichrang. And gleichrein means equal. And if you tune by ears, you will see that you need, if you only take a little bit from the fifths, of course, going up, which is inevitable if you tune the keyboard, and going down, you have faster and slower beats. And so if you tune absolute equal temperament, I mean, diminish a fifth by ear, then you have still a kind of inequality. And Immanuel Bach is actually taking that a step further by saying you have to make the thirds equal, which is extremely difficult to do. So that's my answer to your often posed question, what temperament do I use for the Waldheim-Peter Clavier? It's the equal temperament as Werkmeister describes it in 1707. And you have to look, because this video is going way over 12 minutes, but it's a really hard debated subject, and I don't want to address it in 5 minutes, because I know it will resonate with some people, and I really don't want to to be provocative or controversial, but it is what it is, and it makes sense, because what did we do? We, in the 60s and 70s, we connected the quality of a tonality, or the character of a tonality, to the quality of the thirds. And that is something I've never read in the 18th century sources. Even not, I believe it's Matheson who writes about church tonalities. There he adheres a kind of character to the tonalities. But even then, it's not connecting that to the temperament, to the thirds. They must have wished and demanded, if you read that, and again, that's my interpretation, but it's hard to see it otherwise, they must have demanded a kind of purity, the best purity you can have for the tonality of the keys that you are going to play in. And so if you are going to play in 24 keys, then you need a compromised temperament, which was the Werkmeister 1707 temperament, the Wohltemperierte Stimmung, or the Gleichschwebende Stimmung temperament, like Neidhardt would call it. So I must say, you read it in Gottlob Duch's book in 1789 as well, that it's the primary temperament to play in 24 keys. And then he says, if you don't like that, use Kirchenberger. But Kirchenberger too, who actually divides the whole difference, or the thing you have to divide on over 12 fifths in 2 fifths, there's no one that I know that applies Kirchenberger too exactly as he has written it. My good friend and colleague Miklos Spani has written an article in Clavichord International, very, very precise, how he tunes his instrument. And I know it because I've played regular concerts with him, and he is an exceptionally well tuner. So he modifies Kirnbeck II in a way that there is a beauty in that temperament that's beyond words, and it's possible. Joris Potvlieger as well. I know he starts from a kind of Wegmeister tree, but he stretches some intervals, and if he tunes my instrument, he will never apply equal temperament out of principles. We make jokes about that, but it's really nice and really beautiful. Sometimes he's on the edge, and then I play an A flat major and I say, oh, that A flat C was very big, and of course that's the compromise from an equal temperament. So I can talk on this for hours because it's really, really, really interesting. But you get adapted to that very soon. And try it. And try it really carefully, because... And then after a month, you cannot go back, because... I tell you one secret, and then we stop this video. I'm going to address this in the future again, because I can... I suppose I will have remarks and questions, and that's all appreciated, really. But one secret, so to say, to stop this long video is that when I was making my selection for the 100 CDs on the 100 videos on YouTube, so we have created 3 CDs, our first production for Authentic Sound, I really would have liked to have also the Prelude and Fugue E-flat minor of Book 1 on the disc, but I didn't, because I couldn't listen to my temperament. It was a kind of, what was it? I don't know. Starting point, Werkmeister, Ovalotti. But those thirds sound so awfully out of tune, and it's a pity, because I believe that's one of my best recordings. At the time, I wasn't aware of that so much. I accepted that as being, E flat minor, what do you want? But I realize now that probably was not meant, certainly not by Bach, who was way more progressive than the 19th century portrayed him. And many of us today are still thinking that Bach was looking back, but no one in those times were looking back, and certainly not Bach. And so also his later organ works, like the B minor and the E minor, it's not meant to be played on an equal temperament. It was played, I think, in those days only by the elite of the elite players on the best organs. And most of the organs then probably had a very advanced temperament. So anyway, that's my thought, and that's my temperament for the Wohltemperierte Klavier. I use the Wohltemperierte Stimmung of Werkmeister and feel very happy with that. And again, I'm going to sit down on my instrument once, certainly with the C.P. Bach series, and certainly in next series on the Wohltemperierte Klavier, and you will see that it's a temperament is all theoretical. You can certainly a clavichord, it's impossible to tune exactly. You can tune it very precise, you can tune it to your own taste and to your own habit and to your own ears, whatever you want. But if you would ask me if all the 12 fifths now on my clavichord are tuned a little bit too narrow, I would say probably. But as long as my ear doesn't catch something that I really don't like, I don't mind too much. It's as a fact, looking to the sources, and it's something different what you do with that in your personal life. I'm going to make a video on that, how I deal with, or have made it already. I don't know when this video is going to be uploaded, about how we as musicians, or I as a musician, look to historical facts and how I apply them into reality. And there is something in between facts and performance that we should never forget, I believe. So, there was a long episode. Nature of that, talking about temperament. So, I'm sure you don't mind. Leave your questions and remarks in the comment boxes. Be nice to me, please. Don't burn me like some in some Facebook groups try to do, but that's also for another video. Thanks for watching, and again, if this is your first time here on Authentic Sound, love to have you subscribed and share this video with your friends. Thanks for watching, and everything else with this nice sunset here in Exel at the Hoogsandkapel. they used Meantone temperament when they built that. For sure. Thanks for watching again and see you next time again. Bye.